Well, first of all, I weighed about 115, 16, 17, maybe 118 pounds, soaking wet. I was very thin, and you know I'm short, right? Mm-hmm. But I was constantly playing. When the band would stop playing, I was still playing. Put a mute in and play. And if I had to get off the bandstand, I would go in the men's room and play. And I was on the bandstand playing one night, and Otto Hardwick said, "Man, you always got that horn in your face, and I'm going to name you Little Jazz because you're always playing, you know," and it's just stuck.
Thank you. Little Jazz, the words and music of our legend today, trumpeter Roy Eldridge, there with pianist Oscar Peterson in 1974. Roy Eldridge is often referred to as the link between Louis Armstrong and Dizzy Gillespie, but as we'll hear today, he's an important stylist in his own right. Born in Pittsburgh in 1911, Eldridge began on the piano before taking up the drums. He talked to Charles Fox in 77 about his early experiences, which included playing with the local drum and bugle corps.
I love that. That's one of the things that really used to be just a thrill to, like, on Decoration Day, I'd get up 4 o'clock in the morning. I couldn't wait, you know, and get on the roof with my snare drum and let the sun beat on it to get it good and tight, you know, and tune it up. Yes. And, oh, you don't know what a thrill that was. And that's how I started playing trumpet, really, because they ran out of buglers, and they handed me a bugle and took my drum away from me. And I did all right, because I could blow it. I don't know why, but I just could play it, you know? Mm-hmm. And we had to get in different parts of the woods, the cemetery, when they played taps. And I guess this is what started me being nervous, because when the guy finished and I was supposed to follow him, when he made his last sound, I said, da da dee. And all the kids in my neighborhood was all in, and I was shaking like a leaf. So actually, ever since that, I've been nervous. That's 51 years ago.
What other trumpeters, made an impression on you in those days, or early days?
It wasn't the trumpet players that I really liked. It was saxophone players. Ah. Maybe it's because inwardly my brother was a saxophone player. Now, Coleman Hawkins I liked, Benny Carter I liked, you know? And I used to try to play the things that they played. In fact, I got my first good job by playing Coleman Hawkins' course on Stampede. Mm-hmm. And I good trumpet players, yeah, there was so many of them, but I listened more to saxophone players. That's what really made me have a different style from the rest of the people, you know?
I see, yes. But who were the other trumpet players around then? We're talking now about the 1920s, aren't we?
Oh, it was Jabbo Smith.
He had a pretty fine technique.
Oh, he was good. Played good trombone, too.
Could he?
Oh, he was mean on the trombone. Oh. He was just as good on the trombone as he was on the trumpet. And that's saying a lot. And let's see. It was one guy that, like they talk about Bobby Hagin with changes, Benny Carter's cousin, Cuban Bennett, he was a living in with making changes. He's like the first guy I've heard that was making all these nice changes years ago, you know? It was Bobby Starks. I like Bobby Starks.
Yes. You heard Louis Armstrong records then, did you?
Not really. First records I heard of Louis Armstrong was in Omaha, Nebraska. I think one was Wild Man Blues and the other was Gully Low.
Yes.
Well, I wasn't that impressed, you know. But in 32, Louis was at the Lafayette Theater, and I went to hear him. And I caught that first show. And being a trumpet player, I should have known better, you know. Because people are so unfair. They don't know how hard it is to play a trumpet. It's not like a saxophone where you can just blow and the sound comes out. Those lips, if they don't vibrate, nothing comes out, you know?
Yeah.
They get sore, you can hardly get a sound. So I caught the first show, and I said, oh, man, what is that? So I started to leave. I said, no, I better catch the next show. So I caught the next show, and on the end, he played Chinatown. And at the end of the thing, everybody was standing up, and I was standing up too. Not because they were standing up, because I stood up. It just happened, you know? That's how it affected me. I said, wait a minute, I got to catch me another show. Well, to make a long story short, I caught 4 shows. And after that show, I went out and bought the record of Chinatown. I learned it, and that's when I became, like, working around New York, taking my pick, because I could play Chinatown, you know? Mm. Yeah. And from then on, I've done him, you know.
Eldridge hit the New York scene in the early 30s. One of his first gigs was the Savoy Ballroom with Teddy Hill.